tonight on NewsWatch. Pro-life doctors. Will the Obama administration force them to go against their conscience and perform abortions?
Plus, more union protests in Wisconsin. What are students learning as their teachers march on the state capitol?
And medical breakthrough. A community where no one has died from cancer. Why it could help doctors find a cure. This and more tonight on NewsWatch. Two big decisions on the fight against abortion. Good evening. I'm Lee Webb.
And I'm Wendy Griffith. The House of Representatives today voted to block federal aid to Planned Parenthood. The 240 to 185 vote is a victory for pro-life Americans. The proposal would cut $363 million from the group. It must still pass in the Senate, where Democrats are expected to block it.
But first, the Obama administration is maintaining protections for health workers who have a religious or moral objection to performing abortions. However, the U.S. Department of Health has stripped away some key provisions.
Jennifer Wishon begins our coverage tonight from Washington.
Underlying protections for doctors and nurses who do not want to perform abortions are still in place, but the only part of the conscience rule issued by President George W. Bush right at the end of his term is the enforcement provision that allows healthcare workers to file a complaint with the federal government if they've been forced to perform an abortion against their conscience. The Obama administration says other parts of the Bush rule were confusing and overly broad. The Department of Health and Human Services issued this statement. The administration strongly supports provider conscience laws that protect and support the rights of healthcare providers and also recognizes and supports the rights of patients. Strong conscience laws make it clear that healthcare providers cannot be compelled to perform or assist in an abortion. The rule being issued today builds on these laws by providing a clear enforcement process. A White House official tells CBN News he believes the changes clarify the rules and improve enforcement of conscience protections. He says that addresses some of the suggestions offered by the public during the comments period. Now, the department received more than 300,000 comments on this rule change. Of those, about 187,000 were opposed to any changes to the Bush-era rule. In the CBN newsroom in Washington, I'm Jennifer Wishon.
Doctors have mixed reviews on today's announcement. We spoke earlier with Dr. Mary Davenport. She is with a pro-life medical association.
I think it's too soon to tell whether this is good news for the medical community. It's good in that the Obama administration declared its intention to uphold conscience regulations, but it depends really on the willingness to enforce them.
Wendy Wright joins us now for more on this. She's with Concerned Women for America. Wendy, what is your reaction to today's conscience clause decision?
It's good news and bad news. The good news is the Obama administration claims to recognize that healthcare providers should not be forced to participate in abortions. It's actually their right not to be enforced. The problem, the bad news, is that they eliminated definitions, key definitions in the regulations. So now it may be actually harder to enforce, or it may give reasons for HHS not to enforce the regulations.
Wendy, the other big news today, the House of Representatives approved a plan to cut the funding for Planned Parenthood. This is pretty big. Put this into perspective for us. How big is this?
This is astonishing. I've been in the pro-life movement for 20 years, and it would have been a dream of mine to end the government funding of Planned Parenthood. And it's just it's so thrilling to see that the House has taken that step. Planned Parenthood is the largest abortion provider in the United States. They claim to be the most trusted health care provider for women. Actually, they can't be trusted to protect women, as recent videotapes that exposed Planned Parenthood's collusion with a possible sex trafficker has shown. That Planned Parenthood is willing to side with people who are abusing women and girls in order to make more profit for themselves.
So you think this videotape and these folks that went behind the scenes and really showed what was happening, they're really, I guess, to be applauded for this?
Oh, absolutely. I think that gave the added push that was necessary to get this lopsided vote, this large vote, in favor of defunding Planned Parenthood. And this will only bear well for the women and girls in America. Now, I will say, this is just the first step. Now it goes to the Senate, and President Obama would have to sign it. So we encourage people to be talking with their legislators, especially as their home and their districts next week.
All right. I know you said it was a dream come true for you to see this even pass the House, but what about the Senate? Any chances there?
Well, it remains to be seen if there are enough senators that have the courage to stand up against the powerful Planned Parenthood. Planned Parenthood has insinuated itself in some of the highest places of authority, and they'll do things like put politicians or their wives on the board, their boards. And so we would hope that there would be enough courage among senators. But I think it's partly up to us, the constituents, to give those senators the information, to educate our senators, and to give them the courage to do the right thing. Now, we need to recognize, too, that this may be a several-step process, that even if we don't win this time, we need to come back again and continue our efforts to defund the largest abortion provider in the United States.
All right. Wendy Wright with Concerned Women for America. Thanks for being with us.
Thank you.
Wisconsin is ground zero in state budget battles around the country. The Wisconsin Assembly was hoping to vote today on a budget-cutting bill, but the state's Democrats are in hiding and boycotting that vote. Mark Martin is following the story tonight, and he joins us with the latest. Mark?
Well, Lee, unlike the federal government, states are required by law to balance the budgets annually. And even though tens of thousands of people are protesting the budget repair bill before the Wisconsin Assembly, the measure is eventually expected to pass both chambers. 14 Senate Democrats know that and decided to flee Wisconsin.
The governor of Wisconsin sent a state trooper to round up state Senate Democratic leader Mark Miller. He, along with his fellow Senate Democrats, went MIA to boycott the budget bill. Although Miller did make time for an interview with ABC's Good Morning America from an undisclosed location.
This governor has proposed in just a mere 4 days to strip away people's rights on the pretext of a budget crisis. It's a crisis entirely of his own making.
The state's new Republican governor, Scott Walker, faces a $3.6 billion budget shortfall.
We don't have 15 months to balance the budget. We've got to balance it now. And for those unions that say they want to negotiate, I think it's pretty disingenuous.
The bottom line is we're broke. We can't negotiate for something we don't have an ability to give on.
Walker says the bill would help repair the budget and avoid massive layoffs. The measure, which Republicans are ready to pass, requires state workers to pay more for pensions and health care. It also takes away the collective bargaining rights of most public workers. Tens of thousands of demonstrators have descended on Madison to protest.
I want to do anything in my power to raise awareness that this can't happen.
Hundreds of teachers have joined the protests by calling in sick. That in turn has forced school districts to cancel classes. Wisconsin isn't alone. 44 states and the District of Columbia are projecting shortfalls totaling $125 billion. In New Jersey, Governor Chris Christie was booed by firefighters after suggesting the age of retirement for state workers had to be raised and pension plans had to be cut.
For 20 years, governors have come into this room and lied to you, promised you benefits that they had no way of paying for.
Still, the White House doesn't think what's playing out in Wisconsin is a role model for other states.
Seems more like an assault on unions, and he doesn't see that as a good thing.
Wisconsin Senate Democrats have said they want to negotiate a compromise bill before returning. Now, the bill is projected to save $300 million over the next 2 years. And Lee, I want to reiterate that this budget battle is not just isolated in Wisconsin. Several states are dealing with this. For example, today, Governor John Kasich talking about this. He wants to restrict union rights for public workers as well to offset what he says is an estimated $8 billion budget gap. So not just millions of dollars, $8 billion in Ohio.
Apparently going on in Tennessee as well. This is the fourth day of the protesters showing up in Wisconsin. Who all's there? You mentioned the teachers, firefighters we saw in your video as
right.
well.
Right. Yeah, public workers, students, and teachers are the main three.
Why are the students there?
I think a lot of it is because they don't have class. Basically, the teachers have gone to the Capitol, forcing schools to close, so the students end up, hey, let's check this out, let's
and
see what's going on.
Some of them really don't even know what they're protesting.
Some
is
of
that
them
true?
Are not even sure what they're protesting. Very true. Now, we do want to mention, too, that the demonstrations have been mostly peaceful. However, there are some that have been holding signs comparing Wisconsin's governor to Hitler, the Nazis, Taliban. So it's getting nasty as far as with the signs, but overall it's been peaceful.
Yeah, it was just a couple weeks ago, liberals were telling us to be more civil in our discourse publicly.
Yeah.
Yeah, so much for that.
Okay. Yeah, that's true.
Thank you, Mark. We appreciate it.
Egyptians packed Tahrir Square today in a show of unity and to celebrate the fall of Hosni Mubarak. Tens of thousands streamed past army tanks and military checkpoints, waving flags and chanting, "This is unity. We are followers of Muhammad and Jesus." Islamic Sheikh Yusuf al-Qaradawi addressed the crowd, saying the revolution is not over. CBN News terrorism analyst Eric Stackelbeck argues it's a strategic move for the Muslim leader and his cause.
His program on Al Jazeera, Sharia and Life, reaches millions and millions of Muslims across the region. And he's a guy who really has a lot of respect among radical Muslims as a religious figure. Now, when he speaks today at the rally, he spoke in really moderate tones, talked about unity among all Egyptians and democracy. That's all part of the strategy. There's a concept that our viewers have to remember when a guy like Yusuf al-Qaradawi talks. That concept is taqiyya. This is a concept in Islam that means deception.
Al-Qaradawi has long been an influential Islamic leader. His television show has aired every Sunday on Al Jazeera for the past 15 years.
Egypt is giving two Iranian warships the go-ahead to pass through the Suez Canal. That's the word from Egyptian state media tonight. This would be the first time an Iranian naval vessel passed through the canal in 32 years. Iranian officials say the ships are heading for Syria for training. They insist it will not have weapons or nuclear material on board. Israel's foreign minister calls the move a provocation and says the Jewish state cannot ignore this behavior much longer. CBN News Middle East Bureau Chief Chris Mitchell believes this poses a potential threat to Israel.
The reasons for them for going are several. One could be to deflect attention from their own domestic turmoil right now. The other could be to increase their influence in the eastern Mediterranean, as you said, supporting their states, Syria and Lebanon, right there on the Mediterranean. And the other thing might be to add one more layer of instability and uncertainty in the Middle East, and that fits into their theology that chaos will bring back the return of the 12th Imam, the Shiite Messiah.
And to see that entire interview with Chris Mitchell and hear more about threats facing Israel, go to our website at cbnnews.com. We'll be right back.
Something going on at home?
Don't go preacher on me, man.
I'm not going preacher. I'm your friend.
A man without hope must accept the past.
I am alone. Been alone since I buried my first boy.
And let faith guide him.
What is there to believe in?
You can never underestimate the power of grace.
This February, witness the power of forgiveness.
Are we in this together, man?
The Grace Card, rated PG-13, in theaters February 25th.
If you're an individual, group, or business needing a dental plan, Avia Dental offers group plans for as little as $5 per month. Now members of your group can save up to 50% or more off of high-quality dental care. Everyone qualifies, and there's no waiting or limits on visits to the dentist. Visit aviadental.com or call 1-888-431-CARE. Avia Dental since 1994. Smile, you're with people who care.
Something going on at home?
Don't go preacher on me, man.
I'm not going preacher. I'm your friend.
A man without hope must accept the past.
I am alone. Been alone since I buried my first boy.
And let faith guide him.
What is there to believe in?
You can never underestimate the power of grace.
This February, witness the power of forgiveness.
Are we in this together, man?
The Grace Card, rated PG-13, in theaters February 25th.
When you look in the mirror, can you imagine erasing years of aging?
That's what I used to look like.
Lifestyle Lift takes only about an hour. See the difference immediately.
I'm Linda. I'm 70 years old. Can you believe it?
Call now for a free information kit. It's quick, affordable, and takes only about an hour. Lifestyle Lift, a breakthrough medical procedure that helps remove wrinkles, frown lines, and sagging skin. Call now for a free information kit. Consultations are free. Call Lifestyle Lift today.
South Sudan will become the world's newest country in July. Last month, over 99% of southern Sudanese voted for independence from the north. The North and South have fought a decades-long civil war that ended in 2005 with a peace agreement guaranteeing a vote. Over 2 million people died in the war. South Sudan, Sudan is now working on writing a constitution and building its new government. Jordan Sekulow is with the American Center for Law and Justice. He's in Juba, South Sudan, helping draft that constitution. Our George Thomas spoke with him earlier today.
Jordan, you just got on the ground there. Give us a sense of the mood of the people of South Sudan.
Well, it's an exciting time, George. When you step off the plane here in southern Sudan, you see a sign that says, "Welcome to the 193rd country of the world." And that's what the Republic of South Sudan will become on July 9th. And organizations like the ACLJ, who have been working with the government here in the United States, you know, we're proud to be here, to be able to visit with the people. We were invited by President Salva Kiir. We met with him today, working on legal matters, working on developing a law school program here in Juba. It is a very exciting time, but an important time for Americans to engage, for the especially the Christian community in the United States. And I will tell you, these government leaders understand how important Christian support will be.
What role will faith play in this new country and in the new constitution?
Well, you know, in a large part, people here were fighting for a number of reasons. One of those was religious freedom and a right not to have to live under a strict version of Sharia law if you're not a Muslim and didn't choose to do so. So there's important constitutional values here that are key. And the Christian community here is extremely strong, from Roman Catholics to the Protestant Church. The evangelical movement is very involved in the government. And we as Americans here have an ally in the government of Southern Sudan, in a region of the world where, let's be honest, we don't have a lot of allies.
I was reading somewhere recently, Jordan, that in South Sudan and perhaps in Juba, there are only 40 miles of paved road in that entire part of South Sudan. Talk real quickly about the challenges that are facing this new nation.
Well, sure. The development is not there. I mean, you're talking about decades of civil war, bombings, fighting, people out in the bush. So really what you have here is temporary structures, a few roads going from the airport through the center of town. But the second you turn off that road, even to major compounds, you're talking real dirt roads. And that may be okay during the dry season, but I'll tell you, in the rainy season, it's a real problem, not just for the people who are right here in Juba or outside the country where there's no roads at all, but getting in goods. Think about the
terrific. Jordan Sekulow with the American Center for Law and Justice. Sir, stay safe, and thank you so much for joining us on the broadcast.
Thanks, George.
Up next, wrestling with his conscience. A teenager decides his faith is more important than a battle of the sexes.
The doctor said to me, "Peggy, you don't understand. Pancreatic cancer is inoperable and incurable." And he says, "Well, Peggy, you've got 2 months to live." It was like he was telling me, "Go to the store." There was no compassion. Yeah, it was heartbreaking. My life was an hourglass. I was home, laying on the couch, just dying. My sister Pam called the Cancer Treatment Centers of America. When I got there, I knew that I was going to be cared for. I met with the doctor after the tests were done and said, "How long do I have?" And he looked at me and he said, "Peggy, we did a lot of tests on you, and I never saw one thing stamped on the bottom of your foot that said you were going to die in 2 months. You have no expiration date." I thought, wow.
Cancer Treatment Centers of America is unlike any other cancer hospital, full of hope, committed to your fight. We use every weapon, surgery, chemotherapy, radiation, nutrition, spiritual support, and mind-body medicine. We surround you with a real team, working together, all under one roof.
Each time I went back to the Cancer Treatment Centers of America, I responded better. My tumors were shrinking. Came back in September again, and they still couldn't see anything. I said, "You're kidding me." We'll see how it goes. We'll keep testing, but we can't see the tumors anymore.
Please call the number on your screen to speak with an oncology information specialist and receive a life-changing information kit and DVD packed with valuable information. Call now and learn about treatment options you may not even know exist.
It's really unbelievable how one doctor can tell me I have 2 months to live. And then I go to the Cancer Treatment Centers of America and they save my life. Hope is a mainstay. Hope is everything.
Don't give up. Your fight is our fight. Call Cancer Treatment Centers of America today.
Wouldn't it be wonderful if we could just pop a pill that would prevent us from ever getting cancer?
Yeah, although it sounds too good to be true, scientists say they are one step closer to that goal. And it's all thanks to a rare population of dwarfs. Lori Johnson has that story.
In a strange twist of fate, while a doctor was trying to cure people with dwarfism in a village in Ecuador, it turns out those same little people he was trying to help may be the ones who help millions of others avoid cancer. It is a groundbreaking discovery. Norman Apollo is a full-grown man, but stands less than 4 feet high. He says he remembers long ago as a little boy in elementary school realizing he would never grow any taller. He and others like him were diagnosed with Laronde dwarfism. Dr. Jamie Guevara began studying them in hopes of eradicating their disease. But in the process of figuring out what was wrong with them, he stumbled upon something that was very right. None of them got cancer.
I start noticing, but somehow, in this area that we all know in Ecuador are areas with high rates of cancer, but no one of these patients have ever died of cancer.
Dr. Guevara discovered that the same gene that prevented their bodies from growing also stopped diabetes and cancer from developing. This is remarkable because although scientists have discovered cancer does not grow in mice with dwarfism, this is the first time the same thing has actually been discovered in people.
I think if we did not have the population of the human population, the research would be delayed by years.
Thanks to the 120 little people in this remote part of southern Ecuador, scientists now know that the gene that suppresses cancer and diabetes in mice is the same one that does it in people. So by the end of this year, experiments will begin on adults who are likely to get cancer or diabetes. Lori Johnson, CBN News.
It's amazing. A standout high school wrestler in Iowa has refused to take part in the state tournament because his match was against a girl. He says that would have violated his conscience and faith. Paul Strayton explains.
Joel Northrup, a champion wrestler and homeschooled sophomore in Iowa, has given up a shot at winning at the state level because he'd have to wrestle a girl in the state tournament. His dad, a Pentecostal minister, is standing behind his son's decision.
There's certainly no scriptures that specifically address this, and there's nothing doctrinal and nothing church-based. I just believe this is a principled decision. Joel believes, you know, based on his conscience and his faith, that girls should be treated with dignity and respect. And you know, taking nothing away from those two female athletes, but wrestling's a combat sport. And they're out there, and it gets violent at times, and my son doesn't believe that girls should be engaged in that way.
Northrup's decision has put a spotlight on Iowa wrestling, which is a superstar sport in the state.
It's like the Olympics for high school kids, basically.
And certainly spotlighted the fact women are now central players in what was for years a mostly male sport.
To have a girl get her arm raised at the boys, you know, what has traditionally been a boys' high school state wrestling tournament, it's a moment that's been noticed in Iowa, and now, clearly today, it's been noticed beyond Iowa.
Northrup is getting backing from at least one top female wrestling champ in Iowa.
If it's his religion and he's strong in his religion, then I just respect that, you know, that someone has, I mean, obviously everyone's going to be pointing fingers at him, and, you know, he at least is true to his beliefs, and you have to respect that.
Northrup can compete in consolation rounds, but loses his chance at a first or second place finish. Paul Strand, CBN News.
Well, I certainly applaud Joel and his father for the humility with which they're dealing with this.
And the girl, too. I really think that was nice that she said that she respected the young man.
I would disagree with the father, though. I do think it's a matter of sound doctrine and good theology, because Peter talks about dealing with our wives, or women, with who are the weaker vessel with be considerate, be respectful.
Yeah. I think it's hard to judge in this case because, you know, God may have called her to wrestle and there's not a lot of options for women. So I think we'll have to just
agree to disagree on that one.
Yeah. Well, up next, college rivalry gone bad, a destructive act that could ruin an Auburn tradition.
Finding video on CBN.com just got easier. We've taken all our video, the 700 Club, news, testimonies, teachings, plus our 24/7 channels, and put them in one convenient location, CBN TV. Watch what you want, when you want. It's all simple to find, and now easier than ever to email a story to a friend. CBN TV on CBN.com.
The doctor said to me, Peggy, you don't understand. Pancreatic cancer is inoperable and incurable. And he says, well, Peggy, you've got 2 months to live. It was like he was telling me, go to the store. There was no compassion. Yeah, it was heartbreaking. My life was an hourglass. I was home laying on the couch, just dying. My sister Pam called the Cancer Treatment Centers of America. When I got there, I knew that I was going to be cared for. I met with the doctor after the tests were done and said, how long do I have? And he looked at me and he said, Peggy, we did a lot of tests on you and I never saw one thing stamped on the bottom of your foot that said you were gonna die in 2 months. You have no expiration date. I thought, wow.
Cancer Treatment Centers of America is unlike any other cancer hospital, full of hope, committed to your fight. We use every weapon, surgery, chemotherapy, radiation, nutrition, spiritual support, and mind-body medicine. We surround you with a real team, working together, all under one roof.
Each time I went back to the Cancer Treatment Centers of America, I responded better. My tumors were shrinking, came back in September again, and they still couldn't see anything. I said, you're kidding me. We'll see how it goes, we'll keep testing, but we can't see the tumors anymore.
Please call the number on your screen to speak with an oncology information specialist and receive a life-changing information kit and DVD packed with valuable information. Call now and learn about treatment options you may not even know exist.
It's really unbelievable how one doctor can tell me I have 2 months to live. And then I go to the Cancer Treatment Centers of America and they saved my life. Hope is a mainstay. Hope is everything.
Don't give up. Your fight is our fight. Call Cancer Treatment Centers of America today.
Well, fans of Auburn University, including my co-anchor here, have experienced an emotional roller coaster in recent days.
That's right. It was just a month ago that Auburn fans filled the area of campus known as Toomer's Corner and rolled the historic oak trees with toilet paper to celebrate the Tigers' first national championship since 1957. Rolling the trees is an Auburn tradition that dates back long before I was a student there. But jubilation has turned to sadness because those 130-year-old trees are not expected to survive much longer. That man, 62-year-old Harvey Updike, a self-described Alabama fan, was arrested for poisoning the trees. He even bragged about it on a radio call-in show. Now Auburn fans have returned to Toomer's Corner to show their support for the trees. The story brings to light, though, to those outside of the state of Alabama, just how intense the rivalry is between Alabama and Auburn.
Oh, it's so terrible. It's just tragic.
I spent a lot of time there as a student and celebrated with a lot of my friends and classmates. I talked to Chad Gibbs today. He's written a book. He's an Auburn grad and talks about how he was idolizing following Auburn football, and he wrote a book about it. He says, I pray that Auburn and Alabama rivalry isn't become something I wouldn't want my children to be part of. And judging from the kind emails I've received from Alabama fans, I don't believe it is. That's good to know.
Got to be a good sport. Well, that's all for this edition of NewsWatch.
Good night.
Have a good weekend.